Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Yesterday, I went and visited my friend Jamie, who's a butcher, and got this piece of pork. Because today we're going to make something that goes by a bunch of different names. Could be called Capicola, could be called Capicollo, and if you're a fan of a certain genre of American crime drama, they would call it Gabagool. More on that later, but first I'm going to let Jamie explain what this piece of pork is.
So we're looking at a what's known as a boneless Copa. It comes by a couple of different names. I also know it as a Boston butt, a boneless Boston butt. Something any whole animal butcher should be able to get for you because this is part of the pig. So it's also known as the pork neck as well too, but because pigs really don't have necks per se, it's kind of like almost compacted into the carcass itself, it's also known as a pork neck. So what's gonna happen is Glen's actually gonna be curing this and hanging it to make a capicola.
Thanks, Jamie. You'll also notice that yesterday while I was picking this up, I also got some other cuts here in the dry ager. We got a beef short loin and a pork loin. The beef short loin is going to stay in here for 30 days, and then we're going to cut it up into T-bones, porterhouses, and wing steaks, and we're going to cook those outside over a fire pit. The pork loin, I don't know what I'm going to do with, but it's only going to dry age for about 2 weeks. And strangely, by the time you're watching this video, we'll have already eaten those. So check back and see those videos. This recipe is a bit of a tough one. Like I said, it goes by a bunch of different names. Even the cut of meat goes by a bunch of different names, and it can be dry cured, like I'm going to do it today, unsmoked. It can be dry cured and smoked. It can be cooked and not smoked. It can be cooked and smoked. And all of those are legitimate versions of Capicola, Capicollo, Copa, or Gabagool, depending on where you are from in the world. And as I was looking at this recipe, about the only thing in common was this cut of meat and salt. So salt is the first thing we're going to put in our bowl. The spicing was completely different depending on what region it was being made in or the family that was making it. So it's a bit of a tough one. There's a lot of variation here. So I've chosen a group of spices and herbs that will work for me, I think. This is the first time I've made it, so we'll find out soon. To the salt, I'm going to add Prague powder number one or pink salt number one. And of course, for everyone out there who is opposed to using this, you don't have to use it. Just change the numbers in the recipe. And that recipe is in the description box below the video for everyone who's going to ask. To this, I'm going to add some dried garlic, black pepper, and ground cloves. I'm going to set that aside for a moment. In my little mortar and pestle, I'm going to put some rosemary leaves, some bay leaves, and red pepper flakes, and I just want to grind those up a little bit. So the method I'm using for this is called a measured dry cure or an equilibrium dry cure. And the idea is that the amount of salt and the other spices are based on the weight of the pork. And what this means is that you, at the end of the process, should get a perfectly cured piece of pork that isn't too salty. There are methods where you just sort of pack salt around it, throw as much salt as you can, and then you rinse it later, knowing that you've probably oversalted it, and you might end up with a piece of meat that didn't get enough salt to be cured properly, got too much salt, and is oversalty at the end. This way should, and every time I've ever done it, does give something that has the perfect amount of salt for me. And there's a little bit of variation there. I'm using, between the salt and the Prague powder, 3% of the weight of the meat in salt. The next step is to rub this into the pork. And you want to use your hands, you want to get in there, and you want to rub it into all of the crevices, all of the cracks, anywhere that the butcher may have sliced a little bit incorrectly, or the seams. You want to cover all the sides, and you want to use all of the cure. Now, I'm going to put mine in a vacuum seal bag, just because I've got a lot going on in the fridge, and this is one of the easiest and cleanest ways for me to do it. I can move it around the fridge. I don't really have to worry about it leaking or other stuff coming in contact with it. If what you have is a Ziploc bag, use a Ziploc bag. If what you have is a tub, use a tub. you just pretty much want to get it into something that isn't going to leak, and that you can keep all of your cure in contact with it all the time. Now, this will go in the fridge for 7 days, and every day I'll pull it out, I'll massage it a little bit, I'll turn it over, and I'll stick it back in. 7 to 10 days will do it. It'll probably be cured after 4 or 5, but because I'm doing this measured dry cure or equilibrium dry cure, extra days in the fridge won't harm it because it's not going to pick up any extra salt. So, into the fridge it goes, and I'll see you in about a week. This is now fully cured. Looks great. Let's open it up and see what it smells like. Now, the next step, I'm going to be pretty basic. I'm just going to take it out of the bag and cover it in a mixture of, this is 30% black pepper, 30% red pepper flakes that I've ground up really finely, and 30% nutmeg. So it's third, third, third. I'm going to coat the outside of this with that mixture. Now, I've seen references to people after this initial stage of curing, soaking it for a while in either verjus or grape must. But I haven't been able to grasp how long they soaked them and whether that soaking was part of the process because they had oversalted and it was to draw some of that salt out while imparting flavor, or if I should be adding salt to it in order to keep that equilibrium brine in the right equilibrium. Because if we draw salt out at this point, we'll have drawn too much salt out. Any salt drawn out would draw too much salt out. So I don't know exactly what to do. It's gonna take some experimentation, and I don't think for my first time, I really want to experiment with it. So I could rinse off some of the old spices. I'm gonna leave them on. We'll see how that works out. Skip forward to the end of the video to see if that was a mistake. So I'm just gonna do an even layer all over. Anything I've read just says coat it. They don't really say how much you're supposed to put on. I don't think there's a percentage. I think it comes down to your flavor tolerance, what you're looking for in the end. I kind of like something that's really peppery, so let's get that all over. Next thing we need to do is put a casing on this, and I'm going to use beef cap, which is attached to the beef bung, so you could use either one. I'm not sure if one is larger than the other. I tried to figure that out, and I couldn't. So this comes dry and salted, and you have to soak it, and it took a long time to soak, and I don't need the full length, so I'm going to cut it off. It took a long time to soak. I soaked it for about an hour, and then after that hour, it was finally pliable that I could sort of manipulate it. And then I started changing the water over and over and over again in order to get it pliable, get all the salt off, and also running water into it and then running it out. So we'll see if this goes over. You can order this in different sizes, but you don't know what size it is until you've got it rinsed, and so I was kind of at a loss because I couldn't tell which one was biggest when they were salted. I'm sure there's someone out there who does this every day who would be able to look at it and say, oh yeah, that one's the big one. I couldn't figure it out. So I'm hoping that this fits over. It's kind of stretchy, kind of like a sausage casing. I mean, it's essentially the same as a sausage casing. So let's see if I can get this on. Almost there. So this is messy, it's slippery. There is pork juice flying everywhere. I would suggest you do this in your sink. Success! I'm amazed I got that in there. Okay, so I'm gonna take a piece of string and I'm going to tie this end just like you would a sausage if you had just stuffed a sausage. So get it on there. this knot doesn't have to be anything special. As long as it's tight and we don't allow any air in. So I'm going to tie it first that way. Then I'm going to fold this tail end over and I'm going to tie it again. A lot of people call that a bubble knot. It essentially creates an air bubble or an air pocket or a way so that air doesn't get back in. So it essentially locks it. I'm going to cut off the extra piece here because we don't need it. That's wonderful. Now, I've got some jet net and I'm going to put this on. I'm going to put two pieces on first. And I didn't get the, I'm sure you've heard me say this in other videos, I didn't get the little funnel that helps you put the jet net on. This one is pretty forgiving though. It looks like it's fairly large. So this piece of jet netting is sealed down here at the end. So I need to pull it all the way to the bottom, just like I did with the cap. And just because, I'm going to put a second one on. There we go. Now, I'm going to cut off the excess. And it is sloppy. So down here at this end, I'm going to tie a knot. Doesn't have to be great, just has to be tight. And another one. Now we're going to truss this. So I'm going to take this string, butcher twine, and I'm going to flip it like this so that I've made, okay. And I'm going to flip it like this so that I've made a loop. Pull it under the meat. And then pull it tight. And then do another loop exactly the same and come back. Maybe an inch, and then pull it tight. And then just do the same thing the whole way along. And I make a tag with what it is, the date, and the opening weight. Okay, I've got the dry ager set up down here in the brewery, and I've got the temperature set to 12.5 degrees Celsius and the humidity set to 80. It's a little bit off right now because I've been opening and closing the door as I shoot. I'm gonna hang this inside. I'm gonna make sure that it's not touching any of the other pieces of meat that are hanging in here. Let's see, can I do this without spilling everywhere? And I'm gonna leave it in here until it loses 30% of its weight, which is why we weighed it in the first place. Now, I've never hung a piece this large before in here. I don't know how long it's going to take. So stick around 10 or 15 seconds and we'll find out. Okay, so this Capicola has been down in the dry ager for 3 months, almost 3 months to the day. I put it in at May 13th at 3,007 grams. And it's 1,875 grams now, so we've lost 35 to 40% of its weight in water, and the tying is really loose. So I'm going to get all of the rope and the jet net off, and then we're going to slice it open. You can see over here we got some nice white mold, and that was the beneficial mold that I started on it at the beginning. Didn't grow everywhere. I'll pull all of this jet net off. And that mold is harmless. It keeps the bad mold from growing and it adds a little bit of flavor. Now also on here is the beef bung or beef middle. And I'm gonna attempt to peel that off. I don't like to leave it on. It is edible, but I think I'd like to get it off if I can. And if I can't, I don't know that that's such a big deal. Let's see. Okay, I might fight with that forever. Let's just cut it open and see what it looks like. Moment of truth. Oh, look at that. Okay, now that I've got it cut in half, I was able to get my finger underneath the beef middle, and I'll be able to pull that off. And then we can slice it up and get a taste. Hey, Jules.
Hey, Glen. Hi, friends.
So,
Capicola.
Capicola, or Copa, or Capicollo, Capicola, and if you live in certain parts of New Jersey, Gabagool.
Tomato, tomato.
Yep, exactly. So, smells fantastic. The smell is absolutely incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Oh my.
It is one of my favorite lunch
meat
kind of.
Yeah.
I mean, it's more than just lunch meat, but I think of it as something that I eat with at that time of the day.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing.
Mm-hmm. I'm in.
Well.
Some fresh bread.
Well worth it. That is well worth it. Or even just on a board with, you know, some cheese and pickle.
Mm-hmm.
Or just on a board.
On a board right now.
Right now.
Just moments after it's been sliced, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right, so clearly.
That's amazing. I'm impressed with myself. I am impressed with myself.
We give you a pat on the back.
That worked out really well. Thank you. I was looking for the pat on the back because that worked out really well. So the dry ager certainly makes it very easy to do it because you can control your temperature and your humidity. But 200 years ago, they didn't have that. It just hung in a basement that had a fairly steady temperature and humidity.
In an appropriate room.
In an appropriate room. Or a root cellar. Or if you've got a finished basement that's air conditioned.
That's not the right place.
That's not the right place. Which is why at this point you need something like a dry ager or a dedicated dry aging fridge or something like that. So thanks for stopping by. We'll see you again soon. I will probably be 40 pounds heavier from the Capicola.